One. All right, everybody, welcome to the Insight Cafe podcast. I'm your host, 𝗔𝗯𝗼𝘂𝘁, and today I have my super special guest, Luis, or Pumin Yuvarcharuskul. And Luis here is an amazing entrepreneur from Thailand. He founded Pi Water, which is an alkaline water, and that was really successful. And he also co-founded Eatigo, which is Asia's number one restaurant reservation platform. And today, so when I met Luis, we talked about really behind the scenes of business, like what goes into the mindset or the thinking that goes into creating a successful startup. And I thought it would be so good to explore that with Luis. So welcome, Luis. Yeah. Do you want to introduce yourself?
Yep.
Anything that I miss out in my intro?
No, it's okay. Thanks for having me anyway. So I'm Luis, obviously. Currently co-founded Eatigo, which is, Nikon said, restaurant reservation platform with discount. So in the nutshell, what we're trying to do is that, you know how the restaurants always have like kind of, a full restaurant always have empty table. So what we're trying to do is that we try to turn those empty table into a profit. So the discount, what we do is you do yield management for the restaurant. So the same way as the hotels do price dynamic, the airline do price dynamic, we just try to bring that to the restaurant. So yeah, so it's been a good journey so far for us. We're in 7 countries right now, backed by a couple of investors, including TripAdvisor as well. So yeah.
That's awesome. So, and I'm gonna put the links to both businesses in the description. So for today, I'd really like to start with just diving into the way you think about business. Like when you, well, let's start with Pi Water and then we'll go into Eatigo. Like what was your thinking when you started it? Because I imagine, I think one of the main premises that most startups have is like, you have to be good before you start, or you have to know everything before you get started. So I'd like to just know, what was your thinking when you started?
I think it's more to do with an opportunity then. So I guess, to be fair with you, I think when I was still studying, I think my dad kind of started touching on it. Mm-hmm. So I think he was saying that, hey, there's this really cool water, which has got technology from Japan. But he just not quite sure how to sell it. Mm. Right. So it came back and he sort of like kind of almost conned me and say, hey, son, there's actually no one's running this. Would you try to give it a go? Right. So I think what I do is that basically I try to get as much information as possible. Mm. First. So I know for the fact that basically what is available in the market right back then is that there's a mineral water. Wouldn't say mineral, just normal bottle of water would cost around 7 to 10 baht. Mm. But if you're going to go for the imported water for this, let's say for the same size, the price would jump up to, let's say, 3 times, 30 to 40 baht, right? Mm. And obviously the quality is different. I think the education of water in Thailand is not that high. If you go to Europe, everything you drink is basically mineral water, right? Mm. And if not mineral water, then we call it actually a tap water. So in essence, Thailand has been literally like drinking tap water for so long, which is, I mean, according to some studies, actually not very healthy for you as well, because obviously you want a good quality of water intake, because basically 70% of your body is water. So you want to make sure that all the water you'll be drinking is good as well. So I think at that moment, I realized that what if we can actually do the best water quality in Thailand at half of the price of imported water. So I think I think that's basically the thinking, really. Not, I didn't really think on my kind of, because I was quite young then, I was 21, but I think it's more of the business opportunity that was exploring rather than actually looking at me whether I knew anything.
So what I love about that story is, I'm listening to you and I'm noticing that, like, you, it seemed like a natural curiosity, and like, I wonder if this could work, and just researching it. Like, it didn't feel like you were overthinking it a lot. Like, did that ever come to play, like insecurities about, oh my God, like, can I do this? Or,
to be honest, I was quite young, so I have absolutely no idea what the hell I'm trying to do, right? Yeah. But I think the next thing that I remember doing is basically, what I realized that, hey, if I'm gonna do this, mm-hmm. I probably need the most kick-ass bottle design as possible. right? If
like you're that was the most important thing. Like, never mind business. Yeah. I need a great bottle design.
Yeah. Yeah, I probably need the greatest, because I probably, if you're gonna sell some product which is twice as expensive as what they normally drinks, I think you need something that really stand out. Mm-hmm. And you know, because like our competitors, if you sell kind of normal type of water, right, it's quite difficult to differentiate because they know the market compete quite tightly. So basically, everyone's almost the same price. Mm. So the way they try to increase their margin is basically they try to reduce their packaging cost. You see that nowadays, you see a bottle of water, the plastic is so slim.
Right. And easy.
Yeah, and the cap really. Yeah. So basically, they would say that's for saving the world and everything. But in reality, so they just try to. Yeah, it's about cost saving, right? So I think what we decided that look, we probably can invest in this, so differentiate our product a little bit, and I guess it started from that. So I think it's important that. Because we don't have much money to do any advertising. Mm. So I think we just try our best to actually make our product stand out. We didn't even have like normal wrap label. We went with a sticker. Because if we go with the normal wrap, normal kind of the plastic
yeah, the,
wrap
the plastic
label.
Plastic wrap, yeah.
Yeah, I think that the minimum was you need to do was like 200,000 wow. pieces.
A lot,
but if you go with sticker, right, it's like the minimum is like 10,000. So I was like, nah, what's the point? I'm gonna do 200,000. So we did that, yeah, we stamped the sticker.
Oh man, so and how did you experience growing that to because you got it, you had it in all the shopping malls and all like the grocery stores, like because this really just started from an idea of would you like to try this water business?
I think to be honest with you, I think for the consumer product, I went quite. I think when you're creating a product, it's very important that basically you create something exciting. Mm. This is just true with all the business that when I tutor other people. So also, I think the idea should be exciting enough, like you can actually talk to somebody for like 30 seconds or a minute and mm-hmm. they'll be curious, they're wanting to find more about the product. And I think our water did just that. We have a good designs, and back then about I would say what 15 years ago, alkaline water was totally something new. Mm. Obviously, I think it's been 15 years now that the market just wow. started picking up yeah. and say, hey, this is actually a good, maybe you can almost say that, hey, maybe my product was actually too early for its age. Because I could actually see the trend of people actually drinking, swapping from the soda water into something more healthy. Mm. But I was like, nah, the next natural step would be a vitamin water. Mm. And then eventually you're going to reach water because people will want to get purer and purer and purer, right?
Right.
So I think it was a bit too quick for me to actually go all the way that far. Mm. But I'm still quite confident. I think within next 5 to 10 years, people will actually probably more really be conscious about what they're drinking water from day to day.
I love that because it really points to the kind of knowing or seeing that like business, there is a timing for different businesses, right? Like you mentioned, like okay, alkaline water might have been too early, but noticing that okay, this is where the market is headed.
Yeah. Well, I think it's important to see like the kind of the macro trend as well, because it's just not. I think it's not too difficult to see the natural progression of how the, as you can see now, you're probably going to see when the electric cars start coming out. You kind of knew that eventually.
Yeah,
it's gonna get there eventually, and I think you can actually see that. Hey, after the electric car, gonna be self-driving car, right? It's actually not that difficult to guess. But if you were to launch a full-fledged self-driving electric car, maybe it's a bit too early for the market today. Mm. But you kind of know in your heart that this is definitely the progress gonna go towards this way.
So I have a question. So after doing Pi Water, what about business? look different to you afterwards? Like, what did you see differently coming out of after successfully creating Pie Water? Like, what about your outlook about business changed, or about yourself changed?
I think it's been, I've learned a lot during those 7 years. I think I think being the entrepreneur, I think the good part is that how you'll be able to think about business in kind of this 360 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
You need to be able to pick up on products, designing, marketing, sales, finance, business planning, and all the soft skill about managing, management, all the HR issues, hiring, firing. I think the business was fortunate enough to be at the size where a new grad for me like could learn. Mm. Obviously, my dad was there to help as well. Mm. But I often say that this is basically it's almost like a school for me.
Mm. Like your own school, right? Made for, yes. Luis. Like, yeah.
I think it's really important as well, right? Because I think after 5 years of doing the business, you can actually see that, hey, you starting to stand up from your peers and say that, hey, at this particular age that you're actually slightly more ahead in terms of the career wise. Because I think the challenging has been really tough. And I think when people were thrown into the deep end, the likelihood is that they come out stronger. And the earlier you've been thrown in, I think that's why I think everything kind of come to fruition probably when by the time I started Pie Water. Eatigo.
Eatigo, right? So let's go to Eatigo now. So how did Eatigo come about? So you're doing Pie Water, you're 7 years in.
Eatigo came from a friend of mine, actually. I think a friend of mine from France, mm-hmm. came to Thailand and said, hey, look, they got this interesting business idea. They want to do something to do with kind of food and restaurant. And fortunate enough is that my family was doing the hotel side at the end. And I think at the time, the online travel agent suggested like booking.com, Agoda has been on the rise, right? And I think what they did have was that they guaranteed that if you're going to go to stay at the hotel through their website, they can have like a best price guarantee.
Mm-hmm.
So I think my thinking just went, hey, why don't we just do the same thing that you book the restaurant and you have best price guarantee, I think. And that's where it started, really.
What did business look like to you by the time you went into Eatigo? Because, you know, you'd done Pie Water and you'd kind of got these like business chops, your business experience. What was your thinking besides it being a very simple idea of like, okay, yeah, if you book through us, you should get the best price. Like, did you have like a direction? Did you have like, okay, this is what I want it to be like, or were you still just very curious of like, okay, let's see how this evolves?
I think what I've actually knew by then is that I know the scale of the business.
Mm.
So I kind of knew that, hey, if we're going to do this, right, there's a potential for this to be regional.
Got it.
And then I also realized that I do not have capability of bringing it all the way to do it just by myself.
Mm.
And actually finding the right team. I think this is probably definitely what I did not realize when I was doing Pie Water, right? I think that it's really... The tough thing about Pie Water when I was doing the water was that it's actually a manufacturing scale, but I was running it as a kind of the indie shop house.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's growing to the factory a bit, but I think when you're doing a water, you're talking about kind of ability to produce of like almost a millions or millions of bottles of water per month, and basically like the grand scale of a logistic, right?
Mm.
So I think that I didn't realize that the scale that I was to of business that was entered into. So I was making sure that for Eatigo that I did not make the same mistake again. I was making sure, hey, this business have to be like a proper size and properly funded from day one. Otherwise, that otherwise it would take too long, because I think in the digital age, all the idea moved really fast as well. So I think even in the initial age, before in startup nowadays, that's actually a template where you sort of look. You can run a company from startup. You go to the VC, you pitch them. But I think 7 or 8 years back, the concept of doing a startup did not exist yet. But I realized that pretty soon that, hey, if we're going to do this, we need funding, and we need a professional team who's done kind of a cross-country regional work before. Yeah.
And so having, it sounds like you didn't, because you didn't do that before, right? Like, how did you even begin to approach those things, like building a cross-regional team and getting funding? Like, what was your thinking going into those things? Because, yeah.
It's not to do much of me thinking, but what I was actually trying to do is that I knew that I need to get someone in the team who actually would be complementing to me and bring business to the next level.
Like, you just intuitively knew that, right? Like, you knew you needed someone to.
Definitely, I think that doing a pie water at that stage, I was not accustomed to do anything regional before, and I think this would be too much of a task for me just to walk out and try to get money and try to do a regional business with no experience.
So growing a business definitely means getting more people involved. And I think that's where most businesses either, like, they make it or they fall apart, because the people in the team, right? Like, how did you even go about picking the person? Like, what did you look for? What did you kind of know to look for?
So I was fortunate enough to basically, a friend of mine introduced me to these people who's basically a mercenary. These people, Michael, Sid, and Judy, they used to work together in the telecom company.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to be CEOs running some like big corps. And I think they were just a bit tired of making other people riches. So I think they came in, and these guys have done some like run ex-CEO of the company running, what, $600 million US dollars annual turnover, right? That package is enormous. I always say that, hey, what did you do to get them to work for you, right? The question that I always ask them is that, hey, you need to realize that what do you have for them to pick you as well, right? Because actually forming a team actually takes both ways.
Right.
So I think it's really important to that. It's not that you need them to accept you, but you need to be accepted by them as well. And I think when the idea is exciting enough, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether where it's going to be. But you need to see, hey, are we complementing each other? Is there a possibility of making it more successful if we were to work together?
Mm-hmm.
And I think how the team will form. And I think that's how all the funding, because these guys have been through all the financial trouble and everything. So it was a good match.
Yeah, and I wonder how do you, because to me, like, there's the good match challenge, right? Finding good matches, but then there's also growing and taking care of that relationship through the challenges of doing a startup. Like, how did you manage that? Like, was it always smooth running? Did you guys bump heads? Like, how did you manage those relationships?
So I'll tell you what actually decided that we were going to work together. So during that time before I started Eatigo, right? So that meant that I actually have to quit running Pie Water, and then someone have to hire someone to take over the business, right? So I was not too sure. But then, so I was having this discussion with my mother, and she was like, son, I think you should definitely do Eatigo. Not only that, you've been with Pie Water for 7 years, your learning curve has slow down a little bit, obviously, because you've been in doing the same thing for 8 years. You did computer science, electrical engineering, this kind of stuff. The digital world probably more suited to you, right? And she was like, hey, what are the chances that you can actually work with these people who used to be a CEO of some like multinational company, and there are three of them, and just imagine the stuff you could learn. The company could fail, right? But the opportunity to learn out from those people may not come again.
I love how your mother put an emphasis on the learning curve and seeing how valuable that is. Because to me, I think that's something a lot of people miss when they look at opportunities. They look at more like, what am I going to get? What, you know, rather than like, what am I going to learn?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's what I always said to the new graduate is that, hey, maybe your career path, you should actually think slightly much more in advance. Let's say, hey, by the time you're 30, right, how much salary would you like to earn? Some would say 100K Thai baht to 6K, 10K USD, whatever, right? So I think it's more important to say, hey, it is very important that you need to see the people who's actually earning those salary that you wanted to earn when you're 30 right now. What kind of experience do you have? And I can almost assure them that they actually they pick the right path for them to learn. Because obviously the skill set for you to be good at something have to be accrued over the next 10 years, right? So you need to make sure that you avoid picking some job, which is actually have a good starting salary, but doesn't give you opportunity to learn or get promoted.
Right.
So I think you have to be quite tactical in kind of the career path from day one, rather than actually let just see in hopes that I get that eventually.
I think one thing about that reminded me of what you said was something Quinn Aim from Impact Collective said, and he talked about how, like, I'll give you a 400,000 baht salary, but you need to show me you can create like double that value for the company, like make it worth it for the company. And so to what I think you're pointing to is, you know, before you think about, I just want this salary, think about, can you create that level of value for whoever you're working with through accrued experiences, through that track, and looking like, what's the track you can do to get to create that value?
And it's to do with experience, you need to learn it off. You don't just graduate and become good at something, right?
Yeah.
In order to become good, you need to learn from someone. You need to learn from somewhere, right?
Yeah.
And right? You need to be under a challenging environment for you to learn. You need to be at an environment where actually they throw you into deep end and actually learn quickly, right? Mm-hmm. Because accomplishing an easy task, that will not make you learn.
So I'm curious, how did that journey grow? Because Eatigo obviously became very successful. And how did you grow through that success? How did you grow with the company's growth? Was it hard? Was it easy? Was it challenging? Or like, what was... Yeah.
So, well, if you ask me today, am I surprised that the company become this size when I started? I would probably said, I think we are fortunate, but not that much of a surprise, because, you know, I think when you have the team of this kind of caliber, they said, hey, anything smaller than this is not worth that time. Because these guys, they're big hitter in the previous company, right? Obviously, now they would only be interested in creating some a business upon this scale. So this business scale has been kind of this goal has been established since day one, and that's how kind of the startup or every started, right? And they say that, hey, you try to do a startup and one day you're going to scale to multiple countries and make it successful, and so someday either sell your business or get listed. So you can't really say that, hey, if you start a startup and you get listed eventually, that you're surprised. I think you're just happy that you managed to walk the walk that basically you set out to do from day one.
Got it. And how do you, so from that I can reflect that, okay, there was a clear direction and like kind of intention where you bring in all these big hitters where they're very clear in what they're going to create and the impact they're going to create. And that really helped with the growth.
Yeah. So sometimes you see the wisdom doesn't even have to always come from yourself. Sometimes it can come from your partner as well. Right. And it's always good that you have the right co-founder that you can knock around a few ideas together.
I wonder how you changed throughout this process, because throughout the Eatigo process, like, how have you yourself changed as a person?
I think it's been a tremendous experience, right? I mean, like, 33 years, I get told off by my partners all the time, I think. I think it's just about business acumen, really. I mean, just imagine you're just working side by side as a peer to a CEO who's actually used to run the company with 2,000 or 3,000 people.
Mm.
And I think you just need to be able to learn and say what you like about this style of management, what you don't like about it. And the good thing about me is that I didn't actually have to learn it for one people. I actually have three people to learn off.
Were you ever intimidated kind of working alongside these like people and who in your minds were very, very like big or ahead?
I think they trusted you enough, right? I mean, to be honest, at that stage, so I'm a newbie. I did have like 10 years experience of managing directors as well. But you can actually see the gap, I think. You kind of see the gap of where they are and where you were. But I think as time grew, and if you're a fast learner, you can actually see the gap becoming less and less. But you can almost like from now there, I can actually almost sort of like anticipate what kind of the thing my partner will say, because this is the way of thinking. I probably anticipate what my other partner will probably gonna say because he think like this, right? And I think you just have to pick your shoes, which type of stuff you want, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, there's always a good cop, bad cop going around in an office, and you just look around and say, hey, the good cop actually affects stuff in this way, bad cop experience the stuff in this way. And I think it's really important. I was really fortunate to have a good team. I think one of the story behind our success was actually having a really good director team that I think even 7 years in, there hasn't been a decision which wasn't unanimous.
Really?
Yeah, because I think we all came from the management background, and I think we knew to respect each other. Right, I think it's really important, and I think everybody have their own specialty they know about their own department. Right, I think at the end of the day, the team knew how to respect their forte.
I wonder how you guys navigate conflict, like, because I imagine in business there's challenges and there's obstacles and like, you know, emotions. It's like, how do you guys keep your cool?
Quite easy. So basically, CEO make a final tough decision, and if we are team four, and if other three disagree, we try to veto it.
Okay, so you have a very clear process of decision making.
Well, if it's 2-2, then CEO become a tiebreaker, right?
Okay.
So I think that's kind of the new how the balancing works. So I think it's a good number.
Mm. Yeah. I wonder, looking back, like what are some of the bigger like big lessons you've learned from working in Eatigo, and like, cause it sounds like you've been like your learning curve went like that, like straight up working with all these great people. Like, what are some key takeaways you've gotten so far?
You see, I think I can't stress the learning big enough to be fair. And I think you see, because at the end of the day, you want to be really good. You really want to be the best version of yourself as soon as possible, right? Because the more experience you are, the less likely you are to make a mistake. And the only way you can get become good at something is through the process of learning. You learn through the environment, you learn from doing something of your own, you learn through the person who's much better than you. Right, you try to learn from different environment, and hopefully one day you become established enough to do something maybe with other people again, or something yourself, and hopefully you experience some not to make all those silly mistakes.
So it's
to do with a little bit of the entrepreneurship, to do with the business mind as well. I think the older you get, you kind of actually could see be able to kind of guess this kind of business, you know, work out. I think it's a good idea. This the one that's dead from the start, the stuff like this.
You mentioned your best self. Like, I wonder, because that's a word, I think, a phrase a lot of people use. I wonder, to you, what does your best self mean?
It was it's quite tough, really. I mean, I do have a different take in life at home, because you see, it was a bit quite tough for me to ask me what I'll be doing for the next 5 years under the Eatigo, because I guess I think it's always been my goal from ever since from the university that, you see, I thought of myself that maybe not the cleverest people amongst the clever people, but I also know that basically I'm not as probably not the most stupid either, right? So I often look after the people who's actually running company, who's listed, the guy who's in the magazine, always wondering what is the journey that I need to go through in order from here to go all the way from the guy who's actually in front of the magazine or become a bounty billionaire, right? So it's quite, so even you for yourself, right? You start seeing all this like YouTuber who's actually got millions and millions and you, sometimes you just sit here and you're kind of wondering, what would it take for me to actually get from here to all the way there, right? So that's always been my curiosity. And I think I was fortunate enough to have like my dad and my mom to sort of kind of support me with the key career decision. Not maybe the mentoring part, maybe that I do that the learning part of myself, but when it comes to, hey, maybe I need to quit this company and start a new one, I think they made the right decision for me. So once you realize that, hey, you've become closer to your goal, right? I think then your goals start to evolve as well, because you know that maybe once you hit 1 million followers, right? Maybe 10 million or 100 million followers might not be your goal anymore. Now you start thinking, hey, you start wanting to impact the people. I think for the best version of myself, I think that to be in the position that for me now, I want to be in the position where I can impact a lot of people, right? An ability to walk the path is actually probably the best version of myself. I think that's always a clear goal that actually I enjoy the journey that I'm taking.
Yeah. And I love that. And I love how that's very aligned with kind of the way life works. Like it's not a fixed point. It's an evolving, it's a moving target of experiences and learning curves, and you grow with your business. And also, I think to everybody listening, we all really want to know, like, you know, like, where can we hire your mom and dad? Because obviously that seems to be where the good juice is of business consulting and decisions. Like, well, you need to know, Louis.
if you go look at my sister was, so my sister is in the fashion designer business as well, right? It's called Millen, I think. She was, she's probably the most famous one in the family, to be fair with you. So she also designed the dress for Miss representative of Thailand for Miss Universe and stuff like this, right? So I remember when my mom was like, hey, if we're gonna do it for your sister brand, she's always has this belief that her children are all world beater. They're just missing the a good opportunity.
They're all
well beta. So basically they can do anything that they wish, because we're her son, we're her kids. So she was like, when my sister was doing my fashion brand, she was like, my sister gonna be so good is that we're gonna hire the best event organizer, right? And we're just gonna make it big and make sure that she have the right platform for her to shine from day one. I think that's basically a little bit of throwing your kids into the deep end and see whether it's sink or swim, right?
What was, if I ask, like, was that a lot of pressure? Did that feel like pressure, or just felt like, okay, this is what we're doing?
I think she, because my sister journey has been quite interesting as well, because she, my mother probably knew that sort of like in the fashion industry is quite important for her to be quite connected. So what she did was that she, my sister went through all these three interns at sort of like all this top fashion magazine. Right. And then basically she was having an education in sort of like in New York, in London by then, right? And basically this kind of a magazine will get this this free graduate to work there for free. So I think she's been covering this work for everyone for free. So when she actually launched her collection, all this company came back and actually helped her and push her collection through as well.
Oh, that's really cool. And I know that you help your sister too, right?
Yeah, because she's useless at IT, right? So,
okay. So just so we can save your butt now. Like, she's amazing and she's great, and you're helping her at IT because that's your specialty, right?
Yes. Oh, obviously. I mean, the world's changing fast, right? I mean, it used to be that her distribution channel would be mainly on the department store. But now department store sales and the foot traffic has been declining, and obviously online has been picking up.
And that's cool, because it seems like all your combined experience from Eatigo and Piewater can really just go back to helping your sister and creating that impact through that too.
Yeah, I mean, it's been great. I think what I've actually learned for Piewater is that actually teach you what to realize what you're actually good at and bad at.
And I love how that is just as important as being successful, yes. Right? It's like actually knowing what you're not good at and what you should not be doing, right?
Yes. And if you know you're bad at something, then you actually, this kind of position that you need an experienced guy in this position because you know you're bad at this. And this department, you can actually run yourself because you're quite good at it already, right?
I love that, because I see that as, I think it's like, I wonder if it's even an ego thing. I think most companies in Asia, like, we want to be good at everything. We want to do everything. And really, I think that's what holds us back a lot in trying to do the things that we're really not good at. And like this job should be outsourced to somebody else so you can focus on being good at what you do.
I think that the kind of the Eastern, the Chinese way of doing things is that you want to earn. You're always being taught that don't do business with your friend, right? And then basically you try to do everything of your own, and basically you can move on and pass the business down to generation to generation. But to be fair with you, I don't think nowadays the business actually could last that long anymore, right? I don't think even nowadays, I don't think that many entrepreneurs actually come up with business and think that they're going to pass on to the son and the grandchildren, right? Because with the fast moving world, the business just doesn't last that long anymore. Right. And in order for you to be successful quickly, you need to be able to approach your weak point with a solution. So that would that either you hire someone who's really have the skill set that you lack, or you partner with someone.
I love that. And as we're coming up on time, I'd love for you to, because a moment ago you spoke about impact, I'd love for you to speak to that. Like, you mentioned that now you really want to impact more people. Like, what do you mean? What does that look like to you?
That was a saying, I'm not too sure who it is from, right? But let's say that it is very important for one of the more experienced founders in the Thailand tech industry, right? We always thought that, hey, Thailand probably need to have a unicorn, right? And that might not come from the people from my peers. It could come from the people in the next generation. But what would be really helpful is that people would say that be someone who think you need when you were young. So when other step that ladder that you have to step up when through your learning curve, what you wanted to do for the next generation is that you try not to have them go through the same step, but you send down the elevator for them to pick them up.
Right.
So I think that is very important.
So how are you doing that, if that's important to you?
Well, I think all these lectures, podcasting is important too. But I think just to be available when people like this reached out, right? Yeah. I mean, just try to be as helpful as possible. Introduce them to to the ecosystem.
Well, I think we're really lucky to have you, someone who is intentionally being available to, I love my new favorite word is co-elevate the ecosystem, right? Not just collaborate, but really co-elevate with the intention to raise up the next generation. And lastly, I mean, last question, what would you, if you could give a gift to all the new startups or people thinking about creating businesses, what would you give? And the gift could be a knowledge or wisdom or insight, like what would you give them?
I think if you think that you can handle the risk of failing the business, if you have no problem the business might fail, I would just say just do it, right?
Yeah.
What's the really worst thing that could happen if you have no issue with money, because the learning curve would be tremendous, right? And there's nothing as exciting in terms of the business as a startup in the world anymore, right? Everything in the world just going to go towards being digitalized, and we are at the forefront right now.
That's awesome. On my side, I'd probably give an hour of consultation with your parents or with all four of you, like your parents, you and your sister, just like a panel of like, okay, pitch, go. worth invaluable amounts of money just to consult with the four of you, it seems. But that's really cool. So I really appreciate you coming on and sharing your wisdom and insights. And I think everybody listening is going to get so much value and seeing for themselves, like what goes on behind the scenes, what the thinking that goes on, the learning curves, the little synchronicities between like something your mom said or your father said, or like it really is, to me, just a much, much bigger picture than it looks like on the surface. So I really appreciate you.
Thanks for your time, Nikon.
Yeah, all right. So thank you, everybody. I will see you next time.
All right, take care. Bye.